really fast.
Okay, we're back. We are back, and we are going to talk about a subject, and we're going to let Tay start moderating because she's been saying that I've been dominating the conversation, and she don't like it, and she don't get some respect in the studio, and she's going to just start going off, and she's got her hot sauce in her purse, all that other stuff that, you know, that threatens...
It's hot sauce in my bag.
Yes, in your bag. I'm sorry. Your bag. I'm sorry. So we're going to talk about some stuff. So again, Sean, you posted on the Hot Seat. And by the way, everybody, like and share the Hot Seat and some of our other pages, because we're going to try to get this information out. But this is something, a topic that we need to talk about. And I wasn't aware of it. So we're going to talk about what's the key word? For some reason, I can't.
Eugenics.
Eugenics, mm-hmm. of different groups. And John, take us to
what we need to know. Something I've said before is that we're going to have problems building a stable society as long as we treat people like they're disposable. Whether it starts in some cases from birth, when people are told that their kids are only going to be grow up to end up in debt or in jail or in a gang or something, be a statistic. That's not a good message to be giving teenagers and people that are going to be thinking about having families someday. And it starts there. It starts with the abortion, and it just continues on through. And when they do have kids, the same mentality just continues. It's the kids don't take themselves seriously. And so that's how they do get in trouble a lot of times. And it's once you do have problems with the people that are homeless and in jail and stuff, then that becomes a whole law enforcement issue. And that becomes like a whole nother issue where Now it's not hot. No, at that point, it's no longer abortion that's the hot button issue, but now it's the prison system, whether the police are using excessive force or not, and then some of these people end up homeless. That creates a whole nother issue about disposable people. It's not a way to have a society that comes to respect each other. And it's you can't have a society that discards people and expect it to succeed, because basically it's kind of like eventually it turns into a mentality of like social Darwinism.
And it's funny you say that, because Mary Sanger, who was the founder of, it was something else before it was Planned Parenthood. Mm-hmm. She did believe in Darwinism, survival of the fittest. And their program, the eugenics program, was a part of it, was population control.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mostly of minorities, mm-hmm. Basically saying who was fit to procreate and who was not. A lot of minorities were put in a category of not fit to yes. procreate. That was her thing. We'll do away with them.
And also her agenda was not just to get rid of the minority babies, but also to purge genetic disabilities. Basically, what she wanted was to build a master race, only breeding the most physically fit with the smartest people.
Oh, the Nazi.
A utopia.
Yeah.
Well, that's the thing, is that she did keep correspondence in the 30s with the people, with the doctors that were working that under the direction of Heinrich Himmler.
Mm-hmm. Right, right. Okay.
And it makes me concerned. I've been told, why not... it was rating errors, so take it for what it's worth. She was asking me, why don't I just focus on the white community? Well, if I do that, then that's creating like a xenophobic community, and then that just more let them eat cake. And especially in Moreno Valley, where there is no just standalone white community, and if we're going to fix this town, then we need to all work as one. And in fact, it's what you see on the dollar bill, e pluribus unum, out of many, one.
One, right.
So that's the whole basis of what our country was designed to work on, is working together. And there's no future in, there's not a bright future if we can't do that. And what I'm saying about abortion is not just pro-birth. Mm-hmm. We need to have people adopting. We need to have people providing the daycare. We need people providing mentors and after-school services. I mean, there's a whole list of things that go into raising someone. And while a parent is by far the best choice to do that, if a parent cannot do that, there are other people that need to step up and do something, and that's what we're missing in this town. And luckily, that's something that we can do that does not have, we do not have to wait for the city council. We can do that without them, and it's probably best we do that without them, because we don't need to wait on people that are just going to show up for a photo op and maybe a nice news story and then put that on their Facebook page come next election. We've got people like Pastor Don. There's a variety of programs at the Grove. A lot of the homeless programs are in Riverside. Mm-hmm. But these are all things that we need to do in Reno Valley. The one thing that the city council really needs to work on is providing daycare through the school district because that's really expensive. That's major. That's like really seriously cost prohibitive for a lot of poor families, and that's not helping them getting ahead. We got to get the daycare taken care of. What else do we need?
When you say the cost prohibitiveness, because we are a poor town, I mean, the daycare right there is going to take a big chunk going on.
I will speak that, you know, my youngest went to Hendrick Ranch and now he's in Badger Springs. And those schools have been afforded an after school program that has been free to free to all of the children that can get into that program. Mm. And the one at Season Middle School now, the one at Badger Springs is also free up until I think like six or three or something like that. So for the middle school kids in some elementary schools, it is there. But unfortunately, the number of children that require daycare outnumbers the people that are available to staff support the program. Right. And
does that include from like a couple months old to five?
No, it's school specific. It's grade and age level specific. Now, yeah, as far but as what I was, little
we need
kids,
that too. But what I was talking about was
it's the affordability of care that is outrageous. I know that I've paid when I just read on, I think it was like USA Today, where they said people are paying upwards of thousands of dollars a month just in daycare alone, and it's true. When you have a newborn, daycare is your biggest expense. I mean, I paid more for my little lump who did absolutely nothing versus my five-year-old who was into everything. Mm-hmm. And it's a monopoly. People know that daycare providers have to go through a lot just to get licensed.
Well, I remember growing up, there was no such thing as daycare providers. So,
no, it was your auntie around the corner.
But getting back to eugenics, what was the thing you were saying on the numbers with that lady?
Oh, I forget really.
Margaret Sanger.
Yeah, Margaret Sanger. Just getting back to the topic of what is it? We said 35% of babies that are aborted are black babies.
In some places like New York City, I was looking it up, and it's more like 55%.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think it said too, the article that you put up, only 29 states are reporting their actual abortions. Like, so a state like California is not reporting.
Of course, we're a very liberal state.
So, yeah, so the number is probably actually higher. What is it? 6% of there's 6% black women in the United States. I guess all the women is 6% or something like that. I could be wrong.
Yeah, because we're only 13% of the population.
Childbearing age, in the U.S., the number of childbearing black women. Black women of childbearing age is about 6%.
6%. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And I think a lot of it has to do with, you know, the lack of healthcare services within the black community. where you can go to some cities and there's Planned Parenthoods and they teach, you know, those sexual health, you know, in schools, and people are actually there.
Well, as a Republican, we're shutting those things down so that you
guys... Well, then that's what's going to start these back alley abortions, you know, with people in coat hangers. We're going to start doing that. Because the minute you take away someone's right
to...
They're going to be desperate, and it's going to be revert back to like the 20s and the 30s where you're going to...
And I think that's where the argument is as far as Planned Parenthood. A lot of people see Planned Parenthood as something good, but Planned Parenthood, if you go back to the days of the early 1900s, Margaret Sanger, who actually started Planned Parenthood, it wasn't considered something good. It was a part of the eugenics program. Stop minorities, especially from procreating by sterilization, abortions, just you name it. We do not want them who were considered the inferior race to procreate.
And she also subtly promoted killing off like about 500,000 people with either physical or mental disabilities that were institutionalized.
Well, that would be half the United States right there.
Well, I mean, that's because that was commonplace when you had a child with physical or any type of mental disability. Right. You took them to the sanitarium, you dropped them off, and you went about
your
life. Even
the Kennedys did that.
Well, yeah, but what I'm saying is we need to be working on a society where it's like, oh, the coat hanger abortions aren't being a consideration because we're providing support to the people that need it most.
Right. And I mean, I've always said this, just because you're pro-life doesn't mean you have to take away my choice. Okay. And that's not fair. I mean, you can be pro-life, but how I take care of my body or manage my body has nothing to do with you.
Well, let me ask you this. Since you brought that up, I'm a man. And let's say, you know, me and Tay are dating and something happens, whatever. And, you know, you're like, well, I don't want the baby, but the baby's half mine too. So why is it, you know, and this goes back into like me and Dee, you were talking about this months ago, how like you got a lot of people out there that are made fathers that say, hey, I'm totally irresponsible. I don't want to be a father. But yet some women make that guy the father anyway. And then they're all up in the court system going through hell in a handbasket dealing with that. Now, why is it that, a father like myself or anybody else, we have no say when it comes to our child with that female?
I think there should be a system where if you want to be the father, then you pay for a lot of the medical costs.
Absolutely.
And while your girlfriend or ex-wife or whatever is pregnant, and then once that's done, you take custody and it's your responsibility. Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But I think more or less what you're saying is, so let's say she gets pregnant. She has a choice whether she wants to keep the baby or not.
Right.
But you don't have a choice as a father or a potential father to say, you know what? I don't want anything to do with the baby without...
Or keep the baby instead of abort it.
Right. Without suffering
any
consequences.
Maybe at least have the baby adopted so that you can reconnect with it later.
But the way the rules are set up, the man has no say-so whatsoever in...
Yeah.
But also another thing is, what about like if you ever had a baby, what about like... I mean, maybe you're not ready for the father, but you've got 9 months to hurry up and actually do become a productive father and raise the kid. Because that's the other thing is, it's not just a Black community problem. It's a lot of communities are having
a human problem.
We have so many children in this world that need to be adopted. And the United States makes it so difficult for people to adopt children. They make it easy for people to foster children.
Right. Well, you want to
know
why?
But they make it hard to, and that's why
it can
many
cost like what? Like about 1,000 times more to adopt than abort?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, you want to know why, right? Because we have a prison system that needs product. And so by making it very difficult where these kids are disenfranchised and they don't feel wanted and stuff, they're most likely to become negative about life and do negative things, and next thing you know, there's our
pipeline. Well, if you've got a system that's having kids born so you can stuff them in prison, then that's a whole nother
atrocity. And that's what we have right now.
But if you think about it, because I do believe that is a theory, but who foots the bill in the meantime?
Well,
until they get to the point to where they can go to prison, even though I know they're sending kids to prison as adults at, you know, a very young age.
Our system is very, very smart. We have a thing called the family support, family court system. And that's the system that keeps, you know, again, you have guys that are not the father that are paying for child support. That are, I mean, that's how the system's set up.
And that's the unfortunate part. You know, I know that when I had my youngest, I was in Las Vegas, and it wasn't as easy as, even though we were engaged at the time and we were living together and all that other fun stuff.
And if I was your supervisor, I would have taken care of both of you really quick. Fraternization. No, anyway, go ahead. I'm messing with you. I'm messing with you. I know.
Go ahead. I've always got a problem. But still, it wasn't as easy as him just saying, okay, this is my kid.
Right.
Because even when, fast forward 6 years later when we were getting divorced, the state of Georgia was like, so here's what's going to happen. Mm-hmm. You have to go through parenting classes. And then if he wants, he has to do a paternity, right. Even though we were married.
Right.
But because our last names weren't the same, we still had to do a DNA test. And I was like, that's kind of insulting to me because, whatever. But for those fathers who do, I think the court system is very biased when it comes to men because there are some horrible mothers, horrible people that claim to be mothers and utilize sperm as a direct deposit.
That's exactly what happened to me. That's exactly what happened to me. I feel that I was milked.
Oh, my God.
I just don't understand how my oldest got here. But I had to make a joke of that, but I'm serious. I really feel that's what happened to me. And then I went through 18 years of hell. I mean, not necessarily 18, but, I was forced to pay. Being in the military, I'm gone. But it was just 18 years of hell.
I've seen the court system work, against, and I can only speak for military people because that's, the only realm that I know. No. But, I have, she was a friend of mine. Her and her husband got divorced, and she set his truck on fire. She broke into his house. She did all this stuff with babies with her. And the state of Florida was like, well, he has to pay $1,500 mm-hmm. a month per child in child support.
It's a new hustle.
How do you do that? Mm-hmm. How does that happen?
Boom-quisha.
I once heard it described as, it was a short essay on the internet, but it was called How feminism promotes strip clubs.
Right.
But basically, the thing is that you raise these, you're teaching women to go to college and have mm-hmm. And get these career, but yet they still want to, have a double standard. They still expect to find a man that can take care of them and still make more money than them. And then once they get married, the feminists want to tame them and make their man more feminine. And then if they get divorced, then they're going to get screwed over in the courts. And so that's the thing now is that there's not a whole lot of incentives for men to stay or even to look for a wife, much
you're
less stay
right.
married.
Well, you hit that right on the head. But so in closing and saying that, Don Fleming, I pray for you. I pray you can get out of that. And it's just one of those things because we know Denise Fleming runs the house, and that's how it's gonna be. Get your butt out there to that debate and tell me what's going on. Yes, dear, I'll be there. Right
you know, I will say this: I don't even know what that's about. Okay, I'm not even going to ask. I was somebody posted something online, and it said, and I'm paraphrasing. Men, be careful because there are women out there who are looking to get pregnant so they can get a check and control you for 18 years.
Welcome to the military.
So even though she's, and I'll clean it up a little bit, effable,
okay.
Doesn't mean that she's
wifeable,
pretty much. And so I said, well, why would you want to have sex with somebody who you wouldn't even consider being your kid's mom or your wife?
Because it feels good.
Yeah, okay, but it's all fun and games
until somebody gets pregnant.
Yeah, oh, my God, but she's trying to get me.
But that's what I'm telling my sons. My son will be 18 next month, and I'm like, look, I'm going to just be real.
Wait, what's your son's name?
None of your business.
I already heard about him. I heard some stories about him. Some father was saying some good-looking dude was trying to get with his daughter.
But no, I have to tell my boys. There are girls out there that are, and I'm not
absolutely.
Saying that
you're
all
right.
Women do that, but
you're
there are women that are
right.
out there that, just like there's women, men out there that'll sell you a dream and don't
right.
get caught up in that because that it's a dream. It's not reality. And then you'll be caught up, for 18 years paying for another human being that may not, maybe yours or you.
Well, see, in our situation, Tabby won't have that problem. I'm a little older, you're things good, you ain't got a lot of money, I'm just retired, so.
I may be young, but I'm wise enough.
She's like, I'm leaving that brother alone.
But this is what I was, go back to what I was saying, we can't wait for politicians to help fix this. And in a lot of cases, probably best we don't wait for politicians to fix it, or don't even invite them to come out, because we can't have them screwing over the people that are already screwed over a second time.
Well, yeah, they have their own agenda, and their agenda may not be conducive to what we specifically want. And if our goal is to educate our children to make better life decisions, I think sometimes that has to start at home and with mentorship programs and things like that. And I wish
there's a lot of churches.
I just wish that there were a lot of, you know, because I grew up with the Boys and Girls Club.
Me too.
And, you know, we Bulletin. Had Big Brothers, Big mm-hmm. Sisters, and all these other programs. And out here,
they're all gone.
So
all comes down to finances.
Well, yeah. Mm-hmm. But I think the volunteerism is out there. It's just the gathering of the people. Well, the organization.
Yeah, and I agree with you, but the problem is we are raising a society that expects, like, I'm starting an assistant coach a basketball team, you know, to get my mind off the election and losing. But I'm finding that these kids
are dumb.
No, it's not that they're dumb.
No, they're dumb.
They feel that participation trophies. You know, when I was coming up, if you came in second place, you're a loser. You're a loser.
Well, we're teaching children
that there's no losing.
That
they expect a good job.
Everyone gets a high five.
Right. Everybody gets a good job.
Gets a hug.
Everybody's going to, you know.
And that, you know, we're coddling our children versus allowing them to experience the hurt of defeat.
Right.
And I think going through those emotions, learning to deal with those emotions is something that's healthy. I mean, my parents were like, you know, deal with it and you move on. You don't linger about it. You don't sit there and, you know, hug your pillow and cry and, oh, unbreak my heart in the shower and all this other fun stuff. They're sheltering our children so much, and we're trying to make them so everything is always hunky-dory. Everything is always...
Well, you know, don't you think when you do that, though, you raise these kids that have an expectation of getting a good job?
But that's what I'm telling you. These kids are dumb.
Right.
I mean, I have...
Not my child. You don't talk about my child like that, because my child ain't found.
My son is in sixth grade. My other son is a senior. And these kids come to my house, and these kids are stupid.
Right.
Because their parents aren't teaching them anything.
Right.
They're not teaching them anything.
The tablet, YouTube,
It's not even that. These kids are just disrespectful, and they have no... They're not allowed to think for themselves.
Right. They're told what to think. And
And it's scary.
But you're saying that, but I have a person I know that raised a child. And this child is somebody out of the ordinary. So what was your secret in doing that? What made you different than a lot of Deanna's friends? You know what I mean? You know what I'm talking about?
Well, my daughter will be 24 at the end of this month. So,
yeah, she is that old, everybody. She is that old. Don't let her fool you.
What did I do differently?
The way she thinks is totally different.
I just teach. My father always says this: you cannot teach what you don't know.
Okay.
So I try, and I still do teach her what I do know, and I'm always learning and you know, trying to acquire knowledge, and I teach it to her. Matter of fact, I sent her an inspirational video today, and she said, "Didn't we listen to that yesterday?" And I said, "Oh yeah, I forgot." You know, because I'm always I teach her stuff. Mm. And to be realistic, I've never raised her to be sheltered away from, you know, like I knew some parents who wouldn't let their kids watch Harry Potter because it's evil, it's witchcraft. And I'm like, are you serious? Mm-hmm. Well, we're going to go see Harry Potter and I'm going to explain to her anything that she needs to know. I mean, I didn't shelter her. And some people say kept it real with her. Mm-hmm. So
I don't think there's anything wrong with keeping it real with kids. Kids aren't stupid. And I think people assume that, because he's eight, he doesn't know. There's a way to talk to your 8-year-old, just like there's a way to talk to your 12-year-old, your 15-year-old, your 19-year-old, your 24-year-old. Just like, you know, with sex, I've started talking with my children in age-appropriate terms, starting from when they were small, because, you know, a child molester isn't going to age discriminate. Mm-hmm. And so they need to know what are good touches, what are bad touches, what, you know, and now my son is 18. So we started having the condom talk and this, that, and the other. And, you know, it's only 87%, so don't get caught up.
Mm-hmm. right.
But people refuse. I can't even tell you when I was in the military, my last duty station, I had a lot of young 19-year-olds. Mm-hmm. The one kid, his mom never had to talk with him.
My mom never had to talk. I learned in the streets.
Stop it.
I did, literally. I learned in the streets. You know, I don't want to hear that from my mom.
And you know, a lot of people don't teach their kids how to balance checkbooks. And right. When I went to Cal Baptist, mm-hmm. there was kids who were like, I don't know how to do laundry. And I'm like, mm-hmm. how are you preparing your children to become functional,
adults.
Successful adults when you're not teaching them the basics to actually survive? How do you teach your children not to cook, mm-hmm. not how to use a microwave, how to do any of this?
I don't know. As I became a teenager, there were more and more things that my mom said, I'm just tired of doing this for you.
Yeah, exactly. It cuts you off.
But I have a girlfriend whose children are my kid's age, and she still cleans their rooms. And I'm like, how is your daughter going to go off to college?
Insane.
And she doesn't even know how to clean up after herself.
Well, you know.
Yeah, at some point, like the reason my mom said, I'm tired of doing this for you, is that sooner or later, you got to be old enough to do it yourself.
Yeah, do it yourself. And, you know, but, you know, in my mom's defense, it was like, hey, you're 17, about to graduate high school. You got to get the hell up out of here.
Well, I mean, you know what I mean? I knew I grew up with it's either A or it's B.
Right.
You pick which one, pick your lane and you go with it. Mm-hmm. So I was like, well, okay, well, bye.
Well, one thing I never did was, because especially in the Black community, we have this ideology. Once you're 18, you're getting out of my house. Mm-hmm. I'm going to do me, you know? Right. So not only did I raise my daughter, but I raised three of my niece and nephews. When they turned 18, graduated from high school, was either you're going to work or you're going to go to school. Most of them, probably all of them at this point, one working on his degree, but they have a degree or working on it. But yeah, they were productive. Mm-hmm. That was the way it was going to be. But I didn't believe in putting them out the house because like when I was 18, I was on my own since I was 19. I was very green. I learned a lot, you know?
Yeah, I would say so. All that ditching you did in high school. You're going to have to learn somehow.
But I graduated.
Right, that's true. That's true.
And 2 degrees later, right. Dog. But no, I didn't believe in putting them out the house because I didn't know nothing when I was 18.
Right. Know, but some kids, and like I said, I'm not saying I was a bad kid, but some kids you have to put them out.
I was one of those that wanted to get out. Mm-hmm. So when I turned 18, I was like, okay, I raised my right hand and kept pushing. Mm-hmm. But now that I'm older, I've learned, you know, as a parent, and then I have younger sisters, that it's kicking kids out the nest at 18 isn't always good for each child.
True.
And, you know, I have cousins that still live at home. They're in their master's program, their PhD program. And I'm sitting here like, you learn from other people in other people and parenting styles. Mm-hmm. And I think sometimes you have to keep that child at home so they can grow up at their own pace. And just because you become an adult at 18 doesn't mean mentally you're actually an adult.
The one thing I told my sons when they were going to graduate high school, I said, I don't take care of no grown man. And that's all I needed to say. And the rest is history.
But see, I can't do that with my oldest, though. Yeah. I can't.
Well, no, you're a mom. I'm talking about to man.
I can't do that with my oldest, period, because he has Asperger's.
Yeah.
So okay. I could be like, all right, well, bro, you're 18, you got to go.
No, you're a mom, so you're coming in with a different aspect.
I'm
old school tradition.
I'm
so.
A strict parent. My sisters be like, hey. I'm the one, if your child has discipline issues... Okay. I'm your girl. I've just learned, and maybe it was my oldest that made me kind of rethink that, you know, he probably will need, and he may not be able to ever leave. Mm-hmm. And that's perfectly fine.
Yeah, that's fine. As long as he's productive.
As long as he is productive and he has his goals and he has his things and we're starting to apply for college now. Mm-hmm. So
I'm going to cut you off, but you're saying you're applying for college. He's 18. You're a veteran. So what is the military or the California state program in regards to veterans?
F-R-E.
So for our listeners out there who have teenagers and might be veterans themselves, and their teenagers are sitting on the couch doing jack, how does that program work?
I'm going to say this. If you are a veteran and you are 0% service connected, you get on CalVets. And you get that paperwork and get your baby to any California state school,
RCC, UCR, Cal State, San Bernardino,
Cal State,
USC.
Your children can go to school.
Tuition free.
And I think that is a wonderful blessing that is bestowed upon us veterans.
You know, the funny thing is, I think California is the only state that does
Texas does it.
Okay.
Georgia has a different program about it, but there are other states that are catching on.
Okay.
But your children can go to school. So all you have to do is pay for books. If they're in the dorms, you know, those dorm fees or whatever.
So in California, if the tuition goes up 30% like it did a couple of years ago, does that affect you as a veteran? So I just wanted to get that out. I want to make sure everybody heard that, because a lot of people think, oh, I'm not going to join the military, but there's a lot of benefits.
Oh, the state parks pass. I got my state parks. Mm-hmm. You know, I roll up Lake Paris and we'll barbecue for F-R-E-E.
Okay, good, good. So, you know, go ahead. And I didn't mean to cut you off.
I mean, it's a learning curve, you know, and I...
And now it really makes me wish I could have joined the Marines. There is no way I would have been able to make it in the military.
In the MEPS and stuff like that. But
yeah, MEPS was, that was weird.
But
well, my father wasn't having it, so no military for me.
Right.
Well, I went against the grain because, you know, when my dad and he has five brothers total, but in his household, his two older brothers, one was in the Navy, one was in the Marines. And at that time, it was a sole survivor.
Right.
So my dad, being the youngest, couldn't go into the military.
He couldn't go.
So when I was like, well, I'm going to slide through this boot camp right quick. He was like, absolutely. My parents were against it.
Mm-hmm.
My mom was, we were down at the Padre Inn down in San Diego. My mom was like, I'll cut you a check. I'll do whatever it takes to get you to stay. But now I'm glad I did.
Right. Now, you know, like me being an original person from here, I look at these teenagers running around with nothing to do. They don't want to work at the warehouse because, you know, it was a nightmare working there. And so they're sitting around with nothing to do. And I'm thinking, you've got nothing going for yourself.
But they've eliminated themselves from doing
that. Well, that's part of the reason why I would have preferred to join the military, is because I wasn't really sure what I was going to do when I got out of high school.
But I tell people all the time, if you have no idea where you're going, give military a try. I'm not saying it's for everybody. Do a fresh four, get your GI Bill and run. What's wrong with free school? But
in the Army, there's 2 years. You can do 2 years in the Army.
Well, yeah, 2 years. You can go to the Reserve. You can go to the Guards. You can do a lot of things. But what a lot of people in this city
have... Sorry, phone call.
A lot of these kids have done is they've eliminated their opportunities because they've been in some type of criminal activities, or they can't pass a drug test.
Right,
or,
but if you're playing Halo all damn day, I mean, everything's going to virtual reality. I mean, these were, you know, I mean, even the UAV drivers, that's what they look for, kids that have that ability to look in the box and do that. And that's what I'm saying, these kids that sit around, it's like, you can do that and be very successful in a career in the military. You
know? Right, but unfortunately, like, I've talked to a lot of people, like, I see it on different Facebook pages, and I'm looking for a job, and I'm like...
The warehouses are hiring.
for three months.
Yeah, I mean, but
3 months, and then you're gone. Yeah. But the unfortunate part is a lot of people that I've encountered have, you know, eliminated their opportunities because... You know, they have
bad decisions, right?
And I tell people, don't, what seems like it's cool and it's, you know, to be in them streets isn't going to benefit your future. It just isn't. You know, you want to be cool, you want to be down, whatever, rep your set, whatever. But you can't rep your set when you're 40 years old and you still doing minimum wage work, trying to rob Peter to pay Paul to keep the lights on.
That's not a good look. Tell me about it. So, I mean, Dee, you're pretty good with money, and you know, you could be like my friend Dee here, and you know, she got her a nice Houston man, and you're gonna take all that money there. She's gonna marry into that. And, are y'all gonna live in sin? How does that work?
Define sin.
Well, you know, depending what denomination you are, it comes in all kinds of forms. Okay.
No problem.
But, you know, just real quick with you. So you've had this business, The Polish. Could just tell us a little bit about how does The Polish work? How does that work? I mean, is it just political? Is it, what is it?
No, it's not just political. Basically, what we do is help people to develop a message and teach them how to deliver it to the right audience. And we polish their verbal and visual message, whatever that is. So if they're, you know, a candidate for, you know, city council, or even a salesperson who wants to polish their pitch
presentation,
a presentation. Yes. That's what we do. We help them with that.
Okay. Well, I'm trying to be an actor. Is there any way that I can, you know, get with you and, you know, show me how to studio, because there's different theater acting and studio acting.
You know what? Yeah, a little bit.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah. As whatever your message may be.
Okay. Okay, yeah. Good.
Absolutely.
But we're looking into the holidays. And so, Sean, as we go into the holidays, other than you going out there to 29 Palms or something like that, out in the desert shooting quail and stuff like that, because I know quail's going on, things like that, what are you going to be doing for the holidays?
Not much. It's going to be pretty low-key. Go to church on Christmas Eve and then probably do something with the family, either Christmas Eve or Christmas Day. If my brother's busy on Christmas, then we'll probably just do something with my parents and like, have a nice breakfast or a nice dinner or something like that.
New Year's, any plans, any parties, nothing?
Just stay under the roof to avoid falling bullets.
Yeah, there you go. What about you, Tay?
Christmas always with the family. Mm-hmm. Don't tell my kids. I bought them Disneyland passes.
Wow. Yeah, I saw that's expensive. No. That's an expensive gift.
$3,100, man. That was expensive. Holy. No blackouts.
Yeah, Disneyland every day.
Right. Well,
it's the no blackouts.
Right. So, yeah, so it's a little bit more expensive.
Yeah, it's a little bit more expensive, but my kids weren't raised around here, so they went to Disneyland once back in 2007, and then we zipped off to Okinawa, mm-hmm. so they don't know Disneyland. So.
Right. Well, you're balling like that. I mean, $3,100 to her is like, let me look in my purse.
Shake it out. Oh, it's in the couch covers.
Wow. You know, whenever I spend money like that, I get sick. I literally get sick.
Trust me, ask the people I work with. I was nauseated all day.
I mean, with all the construction I'm doing in here, I mean, I'm literally sick because it's just, I never.
Don't be sick. It's just money.
Yeah, it's just money. I don't mind spending it, but it's just the idea.
Take it with you.
Yeah, but my thing is, you know, good thing about me, everything is cash and carry, so I don't have to worry about that because I saved up for it. But it's just the idea of, oh my God.
Well, then you'll be able to walk around in your nice new, you know, refurbished home and peace of mind.
Well, it's mostly for the animals, you know, the dogs. Yeah, and the no cats, doubt. Okay. Like that, you see, Misty's already got her spot.
Right.
Over there,
she got a little blanket right here and everything.
Exactly. So, what are you doing for the holidays? Okay.
You know, I'm not doing anything.
Are you going to Houston?
No, he's coming here.
Okay.
Yes.
And how long have you've known this young man?
For quite a while.
Okay, he's quite a while.
You gotta put on.
I
love talking about it.
Yeah, she does. I mean, their Facebook posts are disgusting.
No, they're not disgusting. No.
But speaking of which, I mean, I've met Al. He's a really nice guy. Real tall guy, by the way. So, Dee, you have a show on Sundays. I want to let everybody know about that. You do a show on Sundays, live stream. It is called the D Culture Show, or is it K? I'm sorry, you're going by K Culture.
Demetri K. I really don't have a name. My blog that I haven't been on, I'm going to...
Because last week was really a good show. That was really good. I'm sorry I was late, but it was a really good show. So, you know, so where can people find that show if they want to watch it on Sundays? It's at 3 p.m.
On my page, 3 p.m. every Sunday.
Every Sunday.
Mostly every Sunday.
Yeah. Unless she's out of town where she's not supposed to be.
I was out of town the last couple of months because, you know, my mom was ill and...
No, Dee is known to sneak into Houston to see her boo, and without letting me know, I told you I've known this woman for over 30 years. You know, that's a relationship.
She don't know.
Right, that's true. But
let her go be in love.
But that's good. It's good to be with somebody for the holidays. Is Al staying past New Year's? Or
no, he's gonna leave the day after.
Good.
No, we're not gonna do anything. I never really.
Yeah, you're not gonna do anything, right? Okay, I know you. Okay.
No, I'm not. I don't really celebrate the holidays.
Right. You know, you're going to be celebrating. All right. It might not be the holidays, but you're going to be celebrating. But
yes, we're going to be playing a lot of Uno.
Uno.
Yes.
Okay, great. Uno, and politically wise, are you, we have to go to the Eloise Reyes thing. We're going to go interview her. Have you heard from your good friend, Chevron Brown?
That's not my good friend. No, I haven't.
You haven't. Isn't it funny how these candidates go dark and they just disappear?
I don't think she wants to talk to me. You know, it's funny. Did I ever tell you my mom used to write for her?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. My aunt's a good, you know, been known for a long time. But notice how they just go quiet after they lose the election.
Well, they're in their feelings.
It's a morning stage.
This woman collected over
six. They got to go through the seven stages of grief.
Yeah, but this woman collected over $6 million in donations, and she lost and lost badly.
Well, she's probably in Hawaii with that $6 million.
Yeah, $6 million.
Again? Hawaii again? No. But you know, isn't it sad that the black voice now, because she's been defeated like that, is now destroyed?
Destroyed, but definitely credibility. I mean, it's the longest running black newspaper ever in America, and she sold, or as you say, bought in.
She bought into the system.
I would have never wanted to do that to my legacy, because that's what it is, it's a legacy. And she's basically, you know, tying
she's tarnished. Tarnished one term, and she was out of there.
So. I am. My cousin runs the Brotherhood Crusade in Los Angeles.
Wait, isn't that a Muslim faction of? No, it's okay.
Wow.
But I'm going to be working with her to bring a chapter out here.
Uh-oh.
So we can start some mentorship programs.
Oh, for great.
Not just Black youth, but for youth in general.
Yeah.
Great.
So that's just one of my endeavors.
Okay, great. So you're going to get involved in that. So that's really good.
These kids need somebody to look up to. Mm-hmm.
These kids need, we need something for the citizens, not just the children. You know, I hate when people, I don't hate it, but it's just, the minute you say children or, you know, kids, it's like putting a gun to your head, because you want to do the best you can for the kids. But at the same time, we've got to do something for the adults here. We're the ones that are paying the taxes. Yucaipa just broke ground on a civic center. We are the second biggest city in Riverside County. We don't have a civic center. There is, even if you did work at that warehouse, you're still going to take your money, go to San Diego, go to Riverside. You're not spending your money here. That's for damn sure.
Because that's where I go.
Right. Did you see what I'm saying? So all that money, disposable income, is leaving the city.
Menifee just got that Krispy Kreme.
Right. Right.
The line is still, it's been open for like a month, and the lines are still ridiculous.
I don't get Krispy Kreme. I really don't. It's just like, it's sugar pellets.
It is. It's really sweet. I don't get it. I know people, you know, these people are in line. They were camped out in front of, you know, in front of Krispy Kreme.
No.
Like, why don't we have, why can't we have nice things?
No, because we have council people who have no ideas of what we need here.
I shouldn't have to go to Trader Joe's, you know.
In Riverside.
Because my local grocer is Vaughn's, so I have to go to Corona or Temecula. It's not fair that we don't have nice things.
Well, you know, in closing, what I want to say is I really hope that this council works. I really hope that they work to start doing something for the citizens versus this developer. Because it's about time we need to get something. As you guys notice, my streets are getting done. It's been 2 years. Remember when I announced that I had got that done? It's been 2 years. So we're going to get our slick and, you know, LaDonna Jimson's pissed off at me for whatever reasons, but I did not cost you that election, because the question is, where were your friends that voted for you 70% overwhelmingly 2 years ago? But it is what it is.
Well, maybe you two can work together.
No.
I was just suggesting.
Yeah, no, I'm not.
Right now, I'm more curious where the votes that
are missing.
Yeah, and the votes, where are the votes that were made for more than 100% turnout came
right,
from.
Exactly. And this is almost identical to 4 years ago when Baca first took office. So it's kind of strange how this goes about. But speaking of Belle the Wonder Pup, you know, we still have a problem in that animal shelter. Please go to Laura Medetis' webpage. She talks about what's going on in the animal shelter. The killing still goes on, which doesn't make any sense. Felipe, the Latin lover cat, he's running around here somewhere. And please, if you know, a great gift for Christmas is a furry pet.
And did you get that?
Just make sure that you agree with whoever you're giving it to, because otherwise it'll go right back.
Yeah, it'll go right back. Right, absolutely. So
that mobile thing when I was in LA this weekend, it was a mobile pet adoption center.
Oh yeah, I saw that. And brought that up. It's pretty interesting. Yeah. So please think about that. Please stop breeding these animals, especially if you think you can make $300, $400 because you're unemployed or whatever the deal is, because you're causing more of a problem by breeding these animals, because they end up in the animal shelter, then they get killed. Stop breeding if you are not a licensed breeder. Please stop doing that. So this has been a great show. And you guys got any last words and closing comments? And you know, maybe you want to tell people off, or
tell people off.
I mean, Tay, you were in you were right behind Louise Palomares. I hope the farts weren't too much for you.
Oh my God!
You know, I mean, I'm just saying.
She was pleasant
with me. Donovan just asked me for trouble.
Well, the thing is, I'm not a political now, so now I can get to the meat and potatoes of what's really going on. I'm gonna cut loose. So it is what it is. So
no, I was just glad to see Dave Marquez get sworn in.
Yes, Dave. I look forward to working with Dave Marquez. I don't want to work with people who are politically stupid, because that makes me look politically stupid.
I just hope public safety is what's number one for them, because we've got some issues.
Well, I'm going to tell you this. Baca and Gutierrez cut the budget before. They're going to do it again.
Until somebody breaks in their house.
Yeah, exactly.
And then there'll be a problem.
But then again, there's nothing in Baca's house, I think, in that. parents. Oh, I'm just saying, so... It is what it is. I want to tell everybody Happy New Year. We're going to do this, and we're going to be doing video, and we're going to expand. Please check out Sean 14 on the hot seat on all over the place, because he's got a lot of ideas, and he's going to stay on top of it. Health issues, the mental health, homeless. We're going to get on top of all these subjects. So, Sean, thanks again for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
Please keep up the good work with the research. Tay, whenever you can come by, you are always welcome. And the Phantom Menace, D, stop by when you got something you want to drop for us. So we really appreciate it. All right, you guys have a great week. We'll see you next week.